Okay, ready?
Yeah.
Imagine a computer that could solve the world's biggest problems. A computer that could simulate novel materials to help sequester carbon from the Earth's atmosphere, or help us develop new low-cost fertilizers that require less energy and less fossil fuels to produce. Now, there isn't a conventional supercomputer on Earth capable of solving these problems. But quantum computing is a new form of computation that harnesses the power of quantum mechanics and is expected to solve problems beyond the reach of today's classical computer.
So how does it harness quantum mechanics, Finn?
It uses the law of superposition.
And entanglement.
And entanglement.
Yeah. I guess that's all that needs to be said, really, eh?
Basically. You just have to entangle things together. That's that.
I guess you could say, what is superposition and entanglement, really quickly, for people who don't really know or have heard the misinformation, which is plenty.
I'll do entanglement and you can do superposition.
Okay.
Okay. Entanglement. You can have two things and say you get two balls and one is red and one is blue and you put them in one box and then you like shake the box up and then without opening the box, you somehow turn the one box into two boxes and you move those boxes really far apart. They're still closed, so you don't know which one is the red one and which one is the blue one. Those two are entangled. And so the one box on the other side of the globe, as soon as the guy opens it and sees that it's a blue ball, he'll know that the other one is red. But before he opens it, they're both technically equally likely to be both blue and red. Done. How was that?
That was sick. Superposition's way simpler, and you don't need to go into like any special stories. It's just you can have things in multiple states at the same time, and that's about it. In multiple places as well. So, you know, you think about an atom and the things around the atom, and they're like specific things like spin. They're not really spinning, but they can be doing all kinds of things all at the same time. You may have heard of the wave function, which is kind of how we describe, say, an electron. That's not going to help you really understand anything, but like, you know, you can kind of think of the electron being in multiple places at the same time. It's due to the wave, you know, this wave function, but we call that superposition, essentially. And you can, when you do the actual quantum mechanics of it, like the actual math, because of the superposition stuff, you can do all really like funky stuff, and that's probably enough to like get people to go look into it further.
Yeah.
With this nascent technology, we aim to create a supercomputer that seamlessly integrates quantum and classical power together. The same way that today's computers integrate both CPUs and GPUs. We call this quantum-centric supercomputing. And our vision is to build a...
So we should pause here because, like, what's been the approach for a while, Finn, with quantum computing, and why is this a big announcement? Yeah, I'd explain this better than anyone if you get what I'm trying to, like, get out of you. I'll give you a hint, right? For a long time, right, we've been trying to build a quantum computer that's very just separate. This its own little thing, right? Whereas here, they're kind of announcing, okay, we're going to step away from that. We're just going to try and create this QPU, like a little chip, a quantum computing chip sort of thing, and put it in a supercomputer, right? And create an architecture of a normal computer with this little component which can do this, utilize quantum stuff. Whereas, you know, for a long time we were thinking, all right, we're just going to create a separate computer, entirely quantum computationally sort of thing.
Yes. So I guess for me, this idea is lit. It's maybe new to people that aren't in the field, but this conversation about less about quantum computing and more about architecture. Last year, I went to a conference, the Dodd Walls conference, and the plenary speaker talked about this, where actually we thought that we'd build this big, huge machine and it would solve all the world's problems. But the world's problems are actually a lot simpler. You don't need one big machine to solve everything. You can have like a bunch of little machines that are hybrid, like added on kind of thing. It's more dynamic, I guess.
It's kind of like the human civilization, right?
Yeah.
So let's keep watching.
The 100-qubit quantum-centric supercomputer by 2033. so that the world can start tackling its biggest problems. This system will look nothing like the quantum computing that we have today. To achieve this kind of scale and power, we need to develop more advanced engineering, further research into fundamental physics, and push at the very...
So we should say they're kind of giving up on some things here. Like Google is aiming, they have stated publicly many times that they want to build a 1,000,000-qubit device by 2028. You can just Google this. It's on Google's website. And so IBM have been chasing that as well. And they've said the same thing. And they just released the Eagle or the Osprey, the 433-qubit device only a few months ago now, which is the largest sort of little chip in terms of qubits and in terms of quantum computing in general. But there's been a lot of kind of pushback on how big that achievement really is because they're not really connected in a sense. And there's not really any quantum error correction, and all of these terms are so much jargon to it, but it's like, you can't just keep scaling this up because the error correction problem hasn't been sorted. And until we get the algorithms for the error correction, because when you're dealing with quantum stuff on, you know, at the very small scale, for people who don't know what I'm talking about, it's very hard to harness like these superpositions and entanglements. You have to cool things down so things are barely moving. Errors pop up a lot, like a lot of errors. And so it's very hard to create a computer that's reliable without errors. And that's kind of what I'm talking about. So they have to come up with these algorithms to kind of skip over the errors whenever there's like qubits where there's like a problem. And so you need an algorithm to go, all right, ignore these ones. Yeah, and that's really difficult. And we're still trying to do that. So bring it back to why I started saying this. IBM have kind of gone, all right, new plan, guys. They're kind of listening to the physicists, because as Finn just said, physicists for a while have been thinking, why aren't we just focusing on the architecture of a normal computer? He's told me some stories about this as well, which is awesome. So yeah, I think this is actually like a really big announcement, because this is one of the biggest players, right? And they're like, all right, we're gonna aim for that now.
Yeah, there's definitely this bridge between the business and the science kind of thing that for a long time, because quantum physics is so difficult to explain to someone that doesn't specialize in it, justifying like, why aren't you trying to produce this as many qubits as possible and put them on a computer chip and have a whole computer running? Yeah. Trying to justify that has been like very challenging. I'm trying to think how much I am allowed to talk about, because I went to the University of Sydney. Yeah. And they are doing some stuff there, the team there that works for Microsoft. And it's in published papers, a lot of them. So it's actually, I am allowed to talk about it, but I won't say like exactly what they're doing. But essentially, they were diverging from qubit architecture and focusing a lot on cryogenics and working, like creating tools that were like really good tools for operating, like either cooling stuff down really quickly or having really good SMA connectors, which sounds like, oh, what's an SMA connector, Finn? Basically, they were making wires that work really well in cryogenic temperatures. Right. So they don't have this noise, this feedback that you're talking about.
People that are confused right now, cryogenic temperatures like near absolute zero Kelvin.
Yeah.
Zero degrees Celsius, like negative 270 degrees Celsius, right, Finn?
Yeah.
Very cold.
But you know, and people are like, oh, but that's boring, right? Like you're just working on a fancy cable. But actually, this fancy cable is insanely useful, because there's 100,000 people working on the fancy computer. Sometimes you just need like the simple thing to work better for it to like be super innovative and helpful.
Yeah. Well, cryogenics are used for heaps of shit. And I don't think people who, if you don't know much about physics, you might not appreciate zero Kelvin or like what it means to like try and approach that. It's actually theoretically impossible to get to zero Kelvin, for instance. And you're approaching like a limit of nature, right? Like it's wild. But to get off that and to, someone said, Checker said, I thought this would be the idea of future technology, to have computers or even phones with QPUs. So you kind of, I mean, yeah, computers, but you probably, phones, probably not going to happen. This is what, so what they're talking about is like a supercomputer. Supercomputers, people don't just have supercomputers in their phones or even their laptops at all, even today. That's not a thing. So, you know, like QPUs, no. Supercomputers are things we log into, like if you want to do really intense calculations, and they're still like the size of a small house. Like the one I had access to at Swinburne University, which I was doing all the universe simulations on, was literally the size of a small house, the computer. And it had a picture of Einstein watching a black hole on it. It was so sick. I wish I got a picture in front of it, but I didn't. Yeah, we don't even have supercomputers in phones or anything. So I don't know why you think you're going to have a QPU is even harder because like you can't just stick a little dilution fridge in your phone. You know, like yeah. That's maybe impossible.
If you want a QPU, yeah. You need room temperature qubits.
How close are we?
Should we talk
about that paper that's really controversial that blamed, you know, from Australia as well, with, you know, achieve some kind of room temperature superconductor? Did you remember that? You sent me that.
Yeah, it's been a while ago. I haven't.
There was a lot of pushback on it.
If it actually came to pass, like everyone would know about it.
Yeah.
Like good room temperature qubits that don't have some sort of drawback or limitation. But things are just too hot at room temperature, too bouncy.
Yeah. So it might be actually in principle impossible to put a QPU in a phone, for instance, is what we're saying. We don't know the physics of it. So people say who want to go out there and be like, oh, nothing's impossible. Well, you know, we have to still follow the laws of physics.
Very edges of computer science and quantum information theory. We have a lot of work ahead of us, but we already have the first building blocks for quantum-centric supercomputing. It's called IBM Quantum System 2. We shared our designs for...
I feel like that's not fair to call it the edge of computer science because it's like, this is very much the edge of physics, what you're trying to do. Yeah. And before you can worry about the computer science at all, it's like, you got to get the physics right. Like, we don't even know if this is... They're like, they're setting their goals on this, right? But we can both tell you right now, this might not even be possible. Do you think this is possible? This is like saying we're gonna get a human to Neptune. We don't know how we're gonna do it. We're gonna do it. 2033.
There's a lot of money being put into it, and a lot of good things are coming out of it. And until good things stop coming out of it, I think the beauty of quantum physics is like it's the next evolution in engineering for the human race. Because you're basically manipulating, or you're designing at an atomic and subatomic level, pretty sick. Whether or not we actually specifically make a quantum computer, yep. I don't know.
we do have quantum computers, right? Don't make that mistake. Like they do exist. It's just a useful one, right?
Yeah.
Because people who aren't in the field, they always think, you know, we don't have quantum computers. It's like, no, we absolutely do. But they can only, what's the largest number they've factored? Like 20? I don't think it's much higher than 20 at the moment, right? So they're not very useful.
We're in late 2022, and we're planning to share our first working system in 2023. By connecting multiple quantum system twos together, we plan to create systems of many thousands of qubits. But to continue on the path towards 100,000 qubits, we'll need to work hand in hand with the world's finest academic institutions, research organizations, and enterprises. So we're proud to announce that the first partnerships in our journey are with the University of Tokyo and the University of Chicago, both leading institutions in the fields of quantum computer science, quantum components, quantum algorithm design, and quantum communication. Together, we are taking the first steps to make 2033 the year of quantum-centric supercomputing.
Well, I actually think they're not going to stop their efforts for a million qubit device by 2028 because they've publicly stated that as well. I think they're going to like, this is just a tangential project, like a backup plan.
Yeah.
That'll probably take center stage.
Yeah, this to me more than anything feels like the business side of things, like the post-COVID, we're reestablishing our network. We're going to go work with Tokyo and Chicago. Chicago, they have a guy there. He was like a keynote speaker at this one thing that I went to early last year. And his main like research was partnering with all of these different universities to create on-chip devices, as he called it. Nice. And so I imagine that when they say Chicago, that's the number one guy that they're collaborating with, but I don't even remember his name.
Yeah.
So it's like, because even though it's like big, the actual big names, which I hope as I get more depth in the field will be more familiar, especially now that COVID's opened up and you can go to international conferences and you can meet people face to face and see these speakers, you kind of get an idea of like the who's who in terms of the field, like who the professors are and that sort of thing. Yeah, I think it's definitely like they're saying a lot, but they're actually not saying a lot, you know, like
they're just setting a goal. It's like, this is our goal. That's it.
They don't explain how any of this stuff works. They're like, we're not going to tell you what our problems are doing right.
But that, you know, like the whole way business works is it fundamentally relies at the end of the day, good business on secrets, right? They can't just tell us their secrets.
Yeah, yeah.
Otherwise, all the other places in the world trying to do this as well are going to be like, all right, we're going to do that now.
Copy paste. Yeah.
They got to give themselves some like a head start before they tell everyone else.
I guess we'll see.